Good morning, everyone. I greet you this morning in the precious name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. May God's Spirit speak to each one here this morning. I want to welcome each one here, to any of our visitors. May you feel welcome here as well, and as we fellowship and worship together, may you feel at home. I love the Word of God because it is 100% accurate. We know when we read God's Word, everything that He says will take place. Psalm 19, it says, Psalm 19, starting in verse 7, it says, "The law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. The statutes of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes." Psalm 19, verse 9. "The fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. The judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether." What a wonderful verse, wonderful verses we have here. Last time I was here, we finished going through 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. And just to do a bit of a review, I want to continue on with a theme. This morning, my text is Revelation chapter 13. And I've entitled my message, "The Antichrist and His Tactics." To some, it may not be a very appealing topic, but the Lord has given us His Word. God knows all things. And whatever He says will take place. In Thessalonians, 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, the Apostle Paul, he was writing to these young Thessalonian believers. He had only been there, as the Bible says, 3 Sabbaths. He was there a short time and he was forced to leave, and there were letters circulating and telling these young Thessalonian believers that their current persecution was the day of the Lord. And these young Thessalonian believers, they were quite shaken, they were quite disturbed, because they knew what the Apostle Paul had taught them. And the Apostle Paul had taught them that there are certain events that must first take place before the tribulation period takes place. And so he was writing to them, and he tells them that these were false teachers that are writing these letters and claiming to have been written by the Apostle Paul. And he also tells them that their current persecution is not the day of the Lord, often known as the tribulation period. Then he says there's certain events that must first take place. And he also talks about the Antichrist must come on world stage. Now, as we look at our world today, we can see that our world has become more and more marked by political instability and strife. All over the world, societies are characterized by this threat, along with our society's declining morals, increasing crime, and governmental turmoil. We live in a world where right is wrong and wrong is right. We live in a world of information and news. It is so readily available to all. This world is full of corruption and deceit. How do you know what you are reading or seeing is true? Jesus has given us many warnings in the Bible to not be deceived. In Matthew 24, when he was speaking with his disciples, they were asking him, "Tell us, when will these things be? What will be the signs of your coming and at the end of the age?" And it's important to note, Jesus' response is, "Take heed that no man deceive you." We need to take these warnings seriously. Take heed that no man deceive you. They are given throughout Scripture. Today's message is on eschatology, on things to come, on future events. I love studying Bible prophecy for a number of reasons. I serve an almighty God who knows all things. He has revealed events that will take place, and they are written in His Word, in the Bible. Bible prophecy also puts a fire in my heart. Whatever God says and has said will take place. The Bible is 100% accurate. I also love Bible prophecy because He says that He's coming back. As we sang here this morning, I want to thank you for those songs. Soon and very soon, we're going to go see the King. How comforting is that? Jesus is coming back, and God's Word says He will take believers with Him. And He also says that He will judge the wicked and the ungodly. So often we want to do that. God says, "Vengeance is mine, saith the Lord, I will repay." Remember, we have a duty as Christians to pray for one another, to pray for our government, to pray for those who are in authority, and pray for those who are lost. One day Jesus will judge every man's thoughts. It is clear we are all accountable for our own actions. Another reason why I love Bible prophecy, God has given a description of heaven, our eternal home. Something so beautiful that we will never grasp the beauty of our eternal home on this side of heaven. I love how the writer of Ecclesiastes says, God has set eternity in the hearts of men. God has set eternity in the hearts of men. That's something we long for. We can look around us today, we can see the corruptness in this world. We can see our bodies deteriorating. One day that will all come to an end. As we study eschatology, things to come, I want to be humble and tell you, I don't understand every detail of every event. But on the same breath, I don't want an attitude that says, you will never understand it, so why bother studying it? God has given His Word for a reason. It is important for us to study Bible prophecy. I understand that approximately 28% of the Bible was prophetic when it was written. And if you read in Revelation 1, verse 3, it says that there will be a special blessing on those who read, those who hear, and those who obey what God has written. For me as a Christian, it is so incredibly encouraging to know what great future lies ahead for me and for those who put their trust in our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Before we go into my text this morning, I'd ask you please bow your heads in a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for your word. Lord, we thank you for truth. We thank you for your Holy Spirit. And may your Spirit guide us here this morning. May your Spirit convict us and teach us as we look into your word. May you enlighten our understanding. May our response be obedience to you. We give you thanks in Jesus' name. Amen. If you have your Bibles, turn to Revelation chapter 13. Revelation chapter 13, starting in verse 1. And I stood upon the sand of the sea, and I saw a beast rise up out of the sea, having 7 heads and 10 horns, and upon his horns 10 crowns, and upon his heads the name of blasphemy. And the beast which I saw was like unto a leopard, and his feet were as the feet of a bear, and his mouth as the mouth of a lion, and the dragon gave him his power, and his seat and great authority. And I saw one of his heads as it were wounded to death, and his deadly wound was healed, and all the world wondered after the beast. And they worshipped the dragon, which gave power unto the beast, and they worshipped the beast, saying, Who is like unto the beast? Who is able to make war with him? And there was given unto him a mouth speaking great things and blasphemies, and power was given unto him to continue 42 months. And he opened his mouth in blasphemy against God to blaspheme his name and his tabernacle and them that dwell in heaven. And it was given unto him to make war with the saints and to overcome them. And power was given him over all kindreds and tongues and nations. And all that dwell upon the earth shall worship him, whose names are not written in the book of life of the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. If any man hear, or if any man have an ear, let him hear. He that leadeth into captivity shall go into captivity. He that killeth with the sword must be killed with the sword. Here is the patience and faith of the saints. Verse 11, I beheld another beast coming up out of the earth, and he had two horns like a lamb, and he spake as a dragon. And he exercises all the power of the first beast before him, and causes the earth and them which dwell therein to worship the first beast whose deadly wound was healed. And he doeth great wonders, so that he maketh fire come down from heaven on the earth in the sight of men. And he deceiveth them that dwell on the earth by the means of those miracles which he had power to do in the sight of the beast, saying to them that dwell on the earth that they should make an image to the beast which had the wound by a sword and did live. And he had power to give life unto the image of the beast, that the image of the beast should both speak and cause that as many as would not worship the image of the beast should be killed. And he causes all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, to receive a mark in their right hand or in their foreheads, that no man might buy or sell save he that had the mark or the name of the beast or the number of his name. Here is wisdom. Let him that hath understanding count the number of the beast, for it is the number of a man, and his number is 666, or 666. May God bless the reading of his word. This passage here gives a description of the Antichrist character. I understand in this passage, the first beast is the Antichrist, the second beast is the false prophet, and the dragon is the devil. In verse 1, it says here, And I stood upon the sand of the sea, and I saw a beast rise up out of the sea, having 7 heads and 10 horns, and upon his horns 10 crowns, and upon his heads the name of blasphemy. He is called a beast. He is a wicked man. The word beast is the Greek word feroin, which means a wild or a venomous monster. John sees this beast rise up out of the sea, and the beast is emblematic of a man. Why? Notice all the pronouns. Talks about him, his, he. He is a beast because he is wicked. The Bible calls him the son of perdition, the lawless one. Although he may begin as a peacemaker, making a 7-year treaty, peace treaty with Israel, he will break that peace treaty, and it ends very wickedly. I want us to notice my second point here of his world dominance. Now, he appears to Daniel the prophet much like he appeared to the Apostle John. We find a similar description in Daniel 7. Daniel 7 receives a vision of a succession of kingdoms or world-governing empires that will come to the earth from this time forward. Here in Revelation 13, they are in reverse order than what they are in Daniel chapter 7. In Daniel chapter 7, they appear as a bear, a lion, and a leopard. And here we see in verse 2, talks about the leopard, the bear, and the lion. Now, many scholars believe that the lion is is the nation and kingdom of Babylon. It is fierce and ferocious like a lion. Many scholars believe that the bear is symbolic of the Medo-Persian Empire. It is like a bear, it is slower and is strong, and it took over the world after the Babylonian Empire. The third talks about a leopard. Many believe it represents the Grecian Empire. Alexander the Great, he moved swiftly like a leopard, and he took over the world at a very young age. And then if you would read in Daniel chapter 7, it talks about the fourth beast, which Daniel sees, a beast having 10 horns, and it was different from the other beasts. And he talks about this little horn that will rise up from within. And then he talks about it, he describes it as dreadful and terrible and exceedingly strong. And it comes from within. They call him a little horn, or the Antichrist. The Apostle John, he sees the same thing here in Revelation 13. He sees it all wrapped up in one person, has all the characteristics of the others. But I want to note, in verse 7 it says, power was given him over all tribes, tongues, and nations. John sees this beast rising up out of the sea. And the sea symbolizes the nations, or the sea of humanity. You can read that also in Revelation 17, verse 15. He sees this beast rising up with 7 heads and 10 horns. And this leader forms a global confederacy. I understand this 10-king confederacy to be the final world government, consisting of 10 kingdoms under the control of the Antichrist. And as I said earlier, Daniel 7:23, it talks about the vision that he saw, the vision of horns, and he also sees a notable horn, or the little horn, which will rule over these 10-nation confederacy. And the Bible is clear, it says it will trample the whole earth. Now it's been about, I don't know, if it's been 15 years or if it's been more than that, where the term globalism has become a real political buzzword. It is spoken of by many leaders. Global leadership, global coalition, global economy. Now there are several groups in the world today that are pushing for this agenda of globalism. This one group known as the Democratic World Federalists, they have worldwide supporters. This group claims that NATO, the League of Nations, United Nations, that they've all failed to keep the major wars out of this world. And they say the only way to do that is with a global government with a global constitution. They want world economy, world law, and world constitution. Now if we look back or you read in 2011, we know that the Vatican really started to push this agenda. There are several other groups really pushing this agenda of globalism. It is all around us, and then there's been talk for a number of years, this push for globalism. My third point here I want to make is wonder. Verse 3, and I saw one of his heads as it were wounded to death, and his deadly wound was healed. And notice this, that says that all the world wondered after the beast. This beastly ruler is going to be Satan's masterpiece. It says in verse 2 that Satan gave him his power. What does verse 3 mean? I saw one of his heads as it were wounded to death, and his deadly wound was healed, and all the world wondered after the beast. Many scholars believe that this will be the final revived world empire. Speaking historically, there have been six empires that have ruled the known world: the Egyptian, the Syrian, the Babylonian, the Medo-Persian, the Greek, and the Roman Empire. And since that, we have not had a world governance like then. Some believe that this will be the revived seventh empire. Other scholars believe that the Antichrist will receive a head wound, and he will somehow stage some sort of resurrection. I know that Satan does not have the ability to stage a literal resurrection. Only God has the power over life and death. But we know the Antichrist will try to mimic God with a false trinity, and he will try to mimic the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Just as Jesus Christ's resurrection sparked rapid growth in the church, the so-called, or this apparent resurrection by the Antichrist will cause the world to follow him. As we read in verse 3, all the world wondered after the beast. And of course, except for those whose names have been written in the Lamb's Book of Life, as it says here. It says in verse 3 that the world wondered or marveled after the beast. The world will wonder at his rise to power. The world will wonder at his ability to solve problems and certainly wonder at his so-called resurrection or recover from his deadly wound. My fourth point I want to make is worship. Their wonder after the beast will turn to worship. Read it in verse 4 and verse 8. It says, "And they worshiped the dragon which gave power unto the beast, and they worshiped the beast, saying, Who is like unto the beast? Who is able to make war with him?" And notice in verse 8 it says, "All that dwell upon the earth shall worship him, whose names are not written in the book of life of the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world." This is what Satan has wanted all the way along. From the beginning, Satan was the anointed cherub, as it says in Isaiah 14, and it talks about his fall. Satan wanted to be like the Most High God. Satan fell, but he doesn't stop working. Turn back to 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. This text today is just building on verse 3 and verse 4 of 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. It says, "Let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall not come except there come a falling away first, and the man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition." And it describes it in verse 4, "Who opposeth and exalteth himself above all that is called God, or that is worshipped, so that he as God sitteth in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God." It's important to note that the word anti in English means against, but in the Greek language it also means in place of. This is the whole goal of the Antichrist and the devil, is to be in place of God. Satan wants to be in place of Christ. Satan wants to be like the Most High God. When you think of the influence of the Antichrist, or when we think of history, we can look back to some of the dictators we have or have had in the past. even Adolf Hitler, how the world was swayed by him, and not only Germany, but other neighboring countries. At first, Chamberlain thought he was the best, and later they started to see what was going on. If you go back even further, we can read it in Daniel chapter 10 and 11, one of the most famous kings of the northern kingdom, known as the Seleucids, was Antiochus the Great, or Antiochus III, Daniel 11, 10 to 19. He ruled a long time from 223 to 187 BC, and I understand that this was an important phase of Israel's history because under his reign, the control for Israel shifted from the southern kingdom, known as the Ptolemies, to the northern kingdom, known as the Seleucids. This really set the stage for the next step in Israel's history. The mass killings that the Jews would suffer under Antiochus III's evil son, known as Antiochus Epiphany. He was a foreshadowing figure of the future Antichrist to come. When you read Daniel 7 through till Daniel chapter 11, it may be somewhat confusing, but this Antiochus Epiphany was also compared to the future Antichrist to come. Antiochus Epiphany, he persecuted the Jews specifically for their faith, just as the Antichrist will, as we just read here in Revelation 13. It is recorded that he once caught a group of Jews celebrating the Sabbath. He then had the mouth of the cave sealed and fire set inside to suffocate them. Historians record that during the march on Jerusalem, Antiochus Epiphany, he killed some 80,000 Jews, took some 40,000 people, sold them into slavery, and he also plundered and desecrated the temple. And yet, his power came to an end. He would be destroyed in 144 BC when Judas Maccabeus took back the temple. He rededicated it to God in a feast that the Jews still celebrate to this day, Hanukkah. Many times, Antiochus Epiphany, he is referred to as a type of Antichrist. My fifth point I want to make here is words. Verse 5 and 6. This leader will have the ability to sway people. We know that dictators, they use their ability of persuasiveness or persuasive speech to move masses of people. Prior to World War II, when Hitler gave speeches, he would start out very calm and quiet, persuading the people, and as his speeches went on, he got louder and louder, and by the end, he was yelling at his people. But he would sway the people with his persuasive words. And notice what it says here in verse 5 and 6. There was given unto him a mouth speaking great things and blasphemy, and power was given unto him to continue 42 months, or 3.5 years. And he opened his mouth in blasphemy against God, to blaspheme his name and his tabernacle and them that dwell in heaven. He will sway the people with his persuasive words. And as we carry on, we will see the war, the conflict that comes out of this. Verse 7 and to 10. And it was given unto him to make war with the saints and to overcome them. And power was given over all kindreds and tongues and nations, and all that dwell upon the earth shall worship him whose names are not written in the book of life of the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. If any man have an ear, let him hear. He that leadeth into captivity shall go into captivity. He that killeth with the sword must be killed with the sword. Here is the patience and faith of the saints. Once the Antichrist succeeds with influence and domination, then war will break loose. And we read it, I believe it was last time I was here, in Daniel 7, 25, it says that the Antichrist will wear out the saints. We know that in the middle of the 7-year tribulation period, the start of the Great Tribulation, the Bible calls it, the last 3.5 years, where he will wear out the saints. It was given unto him to make war with the saints and to overcome them. If we carry on in my text here in verse 11, it says, "And beheld another beast coming out of the earth, and he had 2 horns like a lamb, and he spake as a dragon. And he exercised all the power of the first beast before him, and caused the earth and them that dwell therein to worship the first beast, whose deadly wound was healed." I understand the second beast to be a false prophet. He comes out of the earth, and he has 2 horns like a lamb, and he spake as a dragon. Just like the devil, he only has the authority that God allows. He is a religious character who supports the Antichrist, and he caused the earth and them that dwell therein, notice as it says here, to worship the first beast or the Antichrist. Verse 13, "And he doeth great wonders also. He maketh fire come down from heaven on earth in the sight of men." I often wonder about this. The Bible talks about all the authority that the devil has, and that he will do signs, lying wonders. It says here in verse 13, "He doeth great wonders, so that he maketh fire come down from heaven on earth in the sight of men, and deceiveth them that dwell on the earth by the means of those miracles which he had power to do in the sight of the beast, saying to them that dwell on the earth that they should make an image to the beast which had the wound by a sword and did live." In order to get the people to worship the Antichrist, he performs great signs and wonders to deceive the people. The false prophet will convince people to build an image for worship of the Antichrist, and many believe it will likely be set up in the most sacred area of the newly constructed Jewish temple. We can only speculate the power that the false prophet will have and how he will deceive the people. "And he had power to give," verse 15, "life unto the image of the beast, that the image of the beast should both speak and cause that as many as would not worship the image of the beast should be killed." Verse 16, "He caused all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, to receive a mark in their right hand or in their foreheads, that no man might buy or sell, save he that had the mark or the name of the beast, or the number of his name." And he makes it clear here that the Antichrist will have that power, the mark of the beast. When you think of ruling powers, they usually have some identifying mark. Nazi Germany had its swastika. The Soviet Union had its hammer and sickle. The idea goes back to early history. Babylon, the first Gentile power, they were symbolized by a lion with eagle's wings, Daniel 7, verse 4. The Medes and the Persian empires, they were represented by a bear rising up with 3 ribs between its teeth. Many have tried to interpret what this mark will be. We don't know exactly what it will be. But the number 6 is the number of man. Humanity was created on the 6th day and commanded to work 6 out of 7 days. The number 6 is a man's number tripled. 6 is also short of the perfect number of 7. I understand the Greek word for mark was always associated with the Roman emperor It often contained the emperor's name, his image, and the year of his reign. It was necessary for trade. It was required on documents to show their validity. I believe the Antichrist mark will serve the same purpose. Whoever does not take this number will be denied to buy or sell. He will cause all to worship the beast. And lastly, and in closing, aren't you grateful that God has given us an insight into future events? Some of this may not be very appealing, but God has given it to us for our instruction. These events will take place. I want to give you some comforting verses. 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 9. For God hath not appointed us to wrath, but to obtain salvation by our Lord Jesus Christ. That's a comforting verse. If you have time, I would encourage you to read Revelation chapter 6 and on. When you read of the tribulation period and God's wrath that will be coming to this earth, it makes your stomach turn. I'm so thankful for these verses. God has not appointed us to wrath, but to obtain salvation by our Lord Jesus Christ. I firmly believe the rapture of the church will take place before the tribulation period. Because when the Apostle Paul was writing to these Thessalonian believers, he was teaching them on the rapture of the church in 1 Thessalonians 4, verse 13 to 18. And we have to remember that the book of Thessalonians was written approximately 50 or 51 A.D., and the Apostle Paul, he included himself when he was teaching these young Thessalonian believers. He says, then we, which are alive and remain, shall be caught up to meet the Lord in the air. He included himself because he knew that Christ could come in his day. How should we live? Titus 2, 11 to 13 says it well. For the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared to all men, teaching us, denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world. Verse 13, looking for that blessed hope and glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from all iniquity and purify unto himself a peculiar people zealous of good works. Verse 13, that is what we need to do, looking for that blessed hope and glorious appearing of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. We're not looking for the Antichrist. We're looking for the blessed hope of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. Jesus says, I will build my church and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. This morning, as I close here, I just want to ask, put the question out there, do you know Jesus as your Lord and Savior? Today, the Bible teaches today is a day of salvation. Do you know Jesus as your Lord and Savior? Today is the day of salvation. We are called to be a light and to live obediently for God. Jesus is nudging your heart today. Don't say no. Tomorrow could be too late. Today is the day of salvation. Let's bow our heads in a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for your word. Lord, you have told us in your word that we are to take heed that no man deceive. Lord, I pray that we would continually go to your word, that we would study your word and know your word, Father. Your truth will keep us from being deceived. We thank you for that. Father, we thank you for Bible prophecy. We thank you that you are an all-knowing God. You have a plan and a purpose for everything. Even though it may seem like evil will have the upper hand, we know, God, that you use it to accomplish your purpose. And Lord, I pray for each one here. Lord, you know every heart here today. You know each one. You know who has denied you. You know those who rejected you. Father, I pray that you would work in each heart. Lord, that we would accept you and believe and be saved. Father, we thank you that you are gracious, you are long-suffering, that you don't want anyone to perish, but all to come to repentance. Father, we thank you for that. We thank you that your word is alive and powerful. We thank you, Lord, that you continually convict. Father, at this time, I want to pray for those that are hurting. Lord, we have many hurting in our congregation, many that are sick, Father, and I pray that you would be near to them. Pray your healing hand be with them. Lord, I pray for Pastor Lloyd at this time, Lord. Lord, you know his heart, and I just thank you for that, Lord. Thank you for the encouragement he's been to me. And Father, I pray for continued healing. And I thank you that you are the Almighty God, the great physician. Lord, I pray if it is your will that you'd restore him to good health. And Father, I pray that you would give him patience. Lord, that you would continually strengthen his faith, that you would bind the hands of the enemy. Lord, I pray for Jane and the family and Brother Henry and Marlene and Uncle Dick and Aunt Irene and the family. Lord, that you would just bring them closer to you. Lord, at this time, I also pray for all those that are contemplating baptism. You know, there's many that have come forward, Father, but there are still some that are debating, Father, that I pray that you would work in their heart. Lord, I thank you for those that have come forward. And I pray that you would give them strength, Father, that you would give them joy. We know it's not about them, but it's about you, you calling them. And Father, I pray as we meet this afternoon, as we want to start, Father, I pray that they would be encouraged, that they would have a hunger and desire to learn more about you. Father, we thank you for each one. I pray you would protect them from evil. And Lord, I pray that we would all been encouraged this morning through your word. And Lord, I pray that we would just continually look to you. I thank you for the promise that you give, that you're coming back again, and you will take believers home, Father. We thank you for that. Lord, until then, I pray that we would take a stand for you, that we would be a light to you. So many that don't know you, Father, and I pray that you would use us and that we would be obedient to reach out to others. Thank you, God, for your love, your mercy, and your faithfulness. In Jesus' name, amen.
crushing wind, so light the fire in my soul, let the flame make me whole, for you know where I've been, so light the fire in my heart.
In closing, I want to say in the world there's so much uncertainty. We don't need to fear. God holds the future and he will take care of us. Our duty is to be obedient to him and follow him. All these end time events are there for a purpose that God will allow to take place to fulfill his purpose. I want to leave you with some encouraging words in John 14. And Jesus says, "Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you, I go and prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also." So encouraging. I want to thank each one of you for coming here this morning. Thank you for the praise team. Thank you for each one who had a part. Thank you for your prayers. And may God bless you for that. Let us bow our heads for the benediction. Now our Lord Jesus Christ himself and God, even our Father, which hath loved us and given us everlasting consolation and good hope through grace, comfort your hearts and establish you in every good word and work. Amen. Thank you for coming. May God's peace and protection go with each one. You're dismissed.